Hello, Unpeelers. Welcome back to yet another episode of Syracuse Unpeeled. I'm Sean Onwualu.
And I'm Sarah Rebetje. And on tonight's episode, we will be discussing Space Jam 2.
The ongoing investigation into the disappearance of Fan Bingbing.
Everything about Milan Fashion Week.
And the Cleveland Browns finally winning a game, their first in almost 2 years.
Spotify is now making it easier for indie artists to directly upload their music to the platform for free. These artists no longer have to use distributors to share their songs.
The platform made the upload feature available, in the Spotify for Artists section on the app. For now, the feature is invite only, so only a few hundred US artists are receiving the offer, but Spotify says it will open to the public in the new future. Sarah, what do you think about Spotify's new feature?
Honestly, I'm really here for it. I mean, I think the distributors usually make artists like pay a monthly fee in order to put their stuff online, and now it allows indie artists who like might not have as much backing like with a record label to just go right and do it on the platform and like get full rights to all of their music.
Yeah, that's very true. My biggest fear is just Spotify becoming, you know, SoundCloud too. You know, people are gonna, you know, everyone posts their SoundCloud links everywhere as Spotify, the new link thing that they're just gonna be throwing out there.
But I feel like it allows like a more creative space, you know, for like smaller artists who like don't have labels.
Spotify is also, I feel, more serious. So
I guess
we'll have to wait and see.
It's not everyone.
They're
only invited.
Yeah.
You know? So it's like a select group of people. Yeah. I feel like they're trying it out.
Well, we'll see when it opens for the public how well it goes. So,
okay, all right.
Transitioning, big news, Space Jam fans, a reboot of the 90s classic will be coming in 2019. Space Jam 2 will feature basketball icon LeBron James and will be produced by the director of Black Panther, Ryan Coogler.
There are also rumors that Michael Jordan will make a cameo, though producers have not yet confirmed. Regardless of whether or not Jordan makes a cameo, the film is a dream come true for James, who said, quote, "I always wanted to be a superhero." Sean, I'm so excited for this new movie. How are you feeling?
I'm very excited about it because unlike Michael Jordan, LeBron can actually like act. He's been in a movie or so and I've seen it. And he was a great actor. So along with the Black Panther producer being on it, I feel like it's going to be a fantastic film.
Yeah, I mean, look how amazing Black Panther turned out. And when you have like a producer like that on a film, I think it'll make it 10 times better.
Yeah.
And I love 90s reboots. I loved the first Space Jam, so I'm personally very excited for the sequel.
I need to rewatch that. This might be
We should have a viewing party.
A movie party?
We should definitely have a Unpeeled viewing party for the new Space Jam 2 movie. I'm so excited because I want to see I want to see like his acting skills. Like, can he really measure up?
I mean, I think LeBron could do it because, as you've seen, LeBron can do anything.
So. That's true. I mean, just another, you know, Emmy to go along with all of his other awards. Well, Mark Saltzman, a former writer for Sesame Street, admitted in an interview that he based Bert and Ernie's relationship on his own romantic relationship with a man. Sesame Street responded with a statement claiming that although Bert and Ernie share many characteristics with humans, they, quote, remain puppets and do not have a sexual orientation.
After coming under fire on social media, Sesame Street has since deleted that statement and instead reaffirmed the show's focus on inclusion and acceptance. Still, they have not said whether or not those two are a couple. What do you think about this whole situation, Sarah?
So Mark Saltzman, you know, he had a partner named Arnie. I think he still has a partner named Arnie.
Bert and Ernie,
like, obviously it's based on him. Like, why can't they be a gay couple?
Yeah.
Let's get rid of those heteronormative values, you know, that we're teaching all our kids these days. Like, why not? Like, what's wrong with that?
I mean, I think the thing that Sesame Street's worried about is, you know, just the public outcry from people who will probably be like, oh, like, this isn't what I watch Sesame Street as. You know, there's always people who like want things to be the same as they were before.
I mean I don't
see a problem with it. I mean, I feel like this isn't the first time people have rumored this.
And I mean, the writer, I mean, if that was like, if he was trying to reflect his own relationship, then it, you know, it makes sense.
Nothing wrong with it.
When we come back, we'll be taking an in-depth look into the disappearance of Chinese actress Fan Bingbing.
So don't go anywhere.
This is the story of a boy who didn't talk for a long time. The boy liked things to always be the same. Any changes would scare and upset him. The unknown was an unfriendly place. The boy was very sensitive to lights and sounds. So he built secret hiding places where they couldn't get in. The boy didn't like looking people in the eye. He wasn't trying to be mean, it just made him feel uncomfortable. Sometimes he would flap his arms again and again.
One day, I found out I have something called autism. My family got me help. Slowly, I found my voice and learned all the ways I could live with it better.
Early intervention can make a lifetime of difference. Learn the signs at autismspeaks.org.
Looking for these? You drive buzzed. It could be one very expensive ride.
First, you gotta make bail. Then pay me to get your car back.
Your insurance premiums will go through the roof.
And my legal fees just keep adding up. All told, it could end up costing you $10,000.
Buzzed, busted, and broke. Because buzz driving is drunk driving.
Welcome back, Unpeelers. Our next story involves famed Chinese actress Fan Bingbing. She has been missing for approximately 3 months. Bingbing is a highly successful actress with 6 million followers on Weibo, a Chinese version of Twitter. People are concerned that the authorities may have been involved in her disappearance because of a tax evasion scandal, which broke in May. But recently, her Weibo account was active, leading to some fans believing that she may come home soon. Patrick, what more can you tell us about this situation?
Well, what I can say about the situation is, well, what we already know. She hasn't made a single appearance since July 1st when she was visiting a hospital for charity. Mm-hmm. And since then, she's just disappeared. Yeah. She hasn't posted on Instagram since May 23rd. Her fiancé deleted all mentions of her on Weibo. It's just a really strange situation that she's just completely been wiped off again. She's basically the Chinese equivalent of Jennifer Lawrence. And at one point, she was one of the top 10 earning actresses in the world, period. Yeah. U.S., everywhere.
Wow. So specifically China has wiped Bingbing, you know, from, like, the face of media.
Yeah, essentially. There was one article that almost came out that basically said that she's under control, complete control, but that article was scrapped. Yeah. Okay.
It was more of a conspiracy theory kind of thing?
Or? Sort of. It seemed like it was probably the truth. China really just wants to have more control over its stars.
Yeah.
And tax evasion is a serious crime because, like, Wesley Snipes a couple years ago,
yeah.
He had some tax fraud issues.
Yeah. No matter what country.
But he was in the public eye.
Why isn't she paying her taxes if she has so many followers?
It's hard when you're famous.
Also,
I can only assume.
Recently China has raised a salary cap on actors because even more so, they just don't want actors to take the spotlight away from their government. Because recently, Peppa Pig, the children's TV show, that was banned from China because people were using it as the start of a revolution. They were just hashtagging it as this counterculture. So it's just kind of weird that people, they just want to have control of the media, and it's a shame the direction that China's going.
It's such an interesting, I guess, time, for the people of China. I mean, I guess we'll have to see if she turns up or what happens to her in the future.
I hope she resurfaces. Yeah. I hope she comes back soon. Yeah.
And as you've seen from the fan support, she's not going away from the public outcry.
Yeah, 60 million followers. That is a whole lot of people.
I'm sure people are rebelling about this.
Also, on her birthday on September 16th, some good news here. They were celebrating her birthday by tweeting out hashtag FanBingBing. Yeah. That got 30,000 tweets and 64 million views.
Yeah.
Oh, wow.
So she's still getting support. Don't worry.
Yeah. We'll have to see where this ends up. So, in more film news, Gary Kurtz, the iconic producer who helped launch the original Star Wars trilogy, has passed away at 78 years old, according to a statement made by his family. Kurtz lost his battle to cancer on Sunday, and in addition to Star Wars, Kurtz, produced many critically acclaimed films, including American Graffiti and The Dark Crystal. Patrick,
Kurtz has helped make Star Wars into what we know today. How did he impact George Lucas?
He had a huge impact on George Lucas's mm-hmm. career. Basically, we might never get Star Wars or any George Lucas films without his impact. He produced his first film, American Graffiti, which was a very big cultural hit, and it mm-hmm. also skyrocketed Richard Dreyfuss's career. Mm-hmm. And then Star Wars, he had a much larger impact than we could ever know. He pretty much was the founder of the Force. He helped bring that to fruition. And a lot of people, when it came out, people thought Star Wars was just going to be a stupid B movie. Yeah. They never realized it was going to be the hit that it could have.
Oh, so. Yeah. We have like cult like fanfiction over this.
It's its whole own supernova of a franchise.
If I ever say anything wrong to a super Star Wars fan, they always are quick to correct me with like
it's
all
like
these
sacrilegious
things.
To say.
Yeah, I know. That's why I don't say anything. I try
never,
to keep my mouth out of it.
If you bring up confused Star Wars for Star Trek, you're going to be losing some friends.
Yeah, actually.
So why did he decide to leave the project?
Well, it seems like today it'd be crazy for a producer to want to leave a project like Star Wars, especially at the peak of its popularity. But the fact of the matter is, he really cared about the art, and he felt like during Return of the Jedi, that Lucas was starting to care more about the toys, and that the toy sell and is really making the films, so the films were getting repetitive.
I respect that.
He just didn't
want
to see that. Yeah. And that you could see that with his next two films he produced, Dark Crystal and Return to Oz, which are for family films, but they're also very, very dark and kind of twisted. So he really cared about creativity, and that's really what you can take away from Kurtz's career as a producer.
Yeah, it seems as though he was a man who, you know, stood up for what he believed in and did more often than not what he wanted to do. So, I mean...
Yeah, well, it's good to hear, and, like, he made an amazing impact on Star Wars, but... Up next, we'll be breaking down the latest adaptation of Avatar: The Last Airbender, so stick around, Unpeelers.
We're gonna go out there in the rain. It's gonna get wet. All right, here we go. Oh, no! Oh, no! Oh, no! Oh, no! Okay, quick. Oh, yeah! Yes! So much fun! Mwah! Yeah, Dad. We're getting so wet.
Hello again, Unpeelers. So our first story for this block, Netflix has announced its plan to create a live-action remake of the popular Nickelodeon cartoon, Avatar: The Last Airbender. Production is set to begin in 2019, but fans are already skeptical about how the show may turn out. Although the creators of the original show signed on as executive producers, even with that, people are still worried because the live-action movie that premiered in 2010 bombed, to say the least. Here to tell us more is our TV reporter, Andrew Goldberg.
Thank you, Sean. And let me tell you, I am super pumped up about this move from Netflix.
Okay, all right.
Now, I know the original Last Airbender show aired a while back when you and I were kids, if you might remember.
Love that show.
But that show was extremely popular. It was very successful. It drew great ratings. It had a good cast, good writing. And now that Netflix is in control, I think they're really going to give it the time and resources it needs to flourish. And I'm really looking forward to see how this show does once it debuts.
Yeah, I mean, it was a show that I watched all the time when I was younger. I know a few of my friends have seen, like, the whole series about, like, a good 5-6 times. Well,
it was interesting.
Yeah, also, Netflix is going to put big bucks because they already are in $7 billion in debt. So they're not afraid to spend money on these shows.
They're not afraid to spend, and they're really, really looking to, you know, continue on with the popularity of the original because it was creative, it was fun, it was something new that people hadn't seen before, and I think it's going to be a big hit. People are really looking forward to this comeback.
So what do you think that Netflix is going to do differently because M. Night... Shyamalan's last film bombed, as we talked about. So what do you think that they can do to improve or like move on from the past film?
Right, and that's a fair question, but I think when you look at the Shyamalan film from a few years ago, there were a number of issues that stood out right away. The writing was poor, the characters and the storyline was kind of underdeveloped, And I think the biggest issue is definitely like the whitewashing of the cast, and that's a very big issue all around Hollywood.
Yeah.
And people were pretty upset, and rightly so. But the good news is, now for this new show, the co-creators of the new Netflix series have come right out and said, this reboot's going to be different, we're going to look for a diverse cast with unique characters, and we're going to make them the story instead of, you know, looking past why are they all the same. Now it's going to be new characters, and I think it's going to be very, very good for the brand.
I'm really excited about the costumes. And speaking of costumes, Milan Fashion Week just wrapped up and brought a lot more than just spring and summer trends. One new aspect was a push for diversity among the models. In addition to having half of their models representing minority groups, they also made sure to include a mix of models of all ages, shapes, and sizes. Joining us to discuss more about the event is our fashion reporter, Olivia Tumino. Olivia, thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you for having me. So as you mentioned, diversity was a huge emphasis all throughout Milan Fashion Week. One designer that really pushed for that was actually Dolce & Gabbana, which was pretty surprising. They had models of all different ages. They had mother and daughter couples walking down the aisle together. They had They had grandmothers and granddaughters. They had plus size models like Ashley Graham.
I love Ashley Graham so much. She's such an inspiration.
They also had models that were 70 years old.
That's
neat. Yeah.
So, maybe doesn't have to just be young. You know?
Yeah, I know, especially in fashion. So even though Dolce & Gabbana seemed to steal the show in terms of diversity, were there any other buzzworthy fashion trends we saw throughout the week?
So Milan Fashion Week is always something that we can look at to kind of find the new trends for the next season. And one trend that really stood out was prints. Bright prints, bright colors, stuff like that. You saw it from Versace to Moschino. And like, it was just all over the place. There was dresses that were based on measuring tape. There was dresses that were based on a thumb. There was actually like a thumb dress. They kind of got creative.
Yeah.
So it was a lot of fun to see. It was a lot of fun to watch. And I can't wait to see where these styles will take us kind of in a street style way.
Wow, that's so incredible. Yeah. I love all the prints, really. Like, I've never been a print kind of person, but they're back in.
Some nice prints for the fall. You know, get some things ready.
Yeah,
you know,
exactly.
Assuming we could afford all that. we could get real nice for the fall. Yeah. So even though there were so many crazy designs dominating runway, there were still like some powerful models on stage. Did any model stand out to you?
So one model that I always love to watch is Kendall Jenner.
Oh,
I think everything she does is amazing. And she actually walked down the Fendi runway in just a oversized white jacket and carrying two purses, actually. So that was, I kind of thought overkill at first, but she killed it as usual. Like, she kills everything.
Of course, she does kill everything.
So there's our Jenner Kardashian plug of the week. So after the break, we'll be talking about the Cleveland Browns' first victory in almost 2 years.
Here's your check. Oh, you got it. You know, since I got rid of my car, I really enjoy walking.
Okay. Got it.
Getting pulled over for buzz driving could cost you around $10,000 in fines, legal fees, and increased insurance rates.
Oh, you're home early.
You live with your mom?
That'll set your game back a few years. Buzzed, busted, and broke. Because buzz driving is drunk driving.
Come on, it's not that hard.
My big man fingers are having a problem with these little tiny buttons.
Whoa, watch it there. Your blood pressure's gonna go through the roof.
Tell me about it. I'm trying to learn how to get it down. Instead, it keeps going up.
High blood pressure can increase the risk for heart attack or stroke. Learn how to keep yours at a healthy range.
Ever hear a voice command? Just say, text Barbershop to 97779.
That's not what I said.
Just give me that. Now my blood pressure's up.
Well, it finally happened. For the first time in 635 days, the Cleveland Browns have won a football game. The win came just 2 weeks after tying with the Pittsburgh Steelers and caused an uproar on Twitter with fans of all teams from the NFL congratulating the Browns. Here to tell us more about the monumental win is our sports reporter, Chris Sacchi.
Sarah, you're absolutely right. Uproar is the precise word to use in this situation. The city of Cleveland right now is just a joyous place to be. I mean, Baker Mayfield came in, number one overall pick, Heisman Trophy winner, came in right before halftime in relief, a 14-0 deficit, and absolutely blew the doors off. And he came back and against a monumental win against the New York Jets.
So considering the city of Cleveland hasn't burned down already, how did the city react to this monumental win?
Oh, I mean, chaos. Yeah. Uproar, all those ridiculous words to describe, kind of like what Philadelphia was like after the Super Bowl.
Oh, man. Yeah, that
oh
was
my
a sight
goodness,
to see.
That was all over Instagram.
It was ridiculous. They acted like, you know, Cleveland acted like the Browns won the Super Bowl. Yeah. You know, fans singing, "We are the champions," uh-huh, in the game, you know, people in stadium, bars, yeah, the streets, all going wild. And just to add to the hype, you know, the Bud Light fridge set to open after the Browns finally set out this
true,
week,
true.
Is, wow, the street. And it finally opened with the city of Cleveland and their fans. So just a joyous occasion for the city of Cleveland.
So why did it take the Browns so long to get this win?
I mean, the easy answer to that question is that they're the Browns.
Yeah,
and,
you
know,
easily.
Losing is kind of what they do, but especially this season, there's been some circumstances where you really have to scratch your head. I mean, in week one, let's start with the kicking issues.
Oh,
a potential game-winning kick, you already know what, yeah, happened. It was blocked against the Pittsburgh Steelers, and all they could do was tie in that game. In week two, the potential go-ahead and tying attempts from the field goal range, they were also missed in the inside final 2 minutes. So really, the Browns should be 3-0 at this point, but they finally cracked the win column at 1-1-1, the record so far.
All right. So with all this hype going forward, do you think the Browns wait another 600 days for a win?
I mean, hopefully not for the city of Cleveland, but, you know, this time around, I don't see it really taking this long. Baker Mayfield is injecting some hype, some energy into a team, and he's talked about not just winning one game, but establishing a winning culture. And for a guy who went from walk-on to Heisman Trophy winner Oklahoma, he's done some extraordinary things, but I think this might be his most difficult task yet as a quarterback.
Of course.
Well, I, for one, am happy for Cleveland. And on Sunday, another long-awaited win went to Tiger Woods. The world-famous golfer won his first PGA Tour since 2013. Woods holds the Guinness World Record for most U.S. PGA Tour tournament wins in the modern era. Chris, what more can you tell us about this latest win?
I mean, really, Tiger, of course, before this, he was already one of the greats, but he's really established himself as a second-tier. Kind of like how Kobe Bryant put up 60 in his final game. Something like that. His career isn't even over yet. We talk about maybe, you know, he came back after 4 back surgeries. Some people were shocked that he can even walk around without pain, stand up, and now he's playing golf at a high level again. This gets America very excited, of course. Whenever Tiger gets going, you see notifications on Twitter from ESPN.
The whole world blows up.
Everyone's waiting, you know, is Tiger back? Is Tiger back? And, you know, when he came back this December, he was ranked as the 1,199th player in golf in the world. And
disrespectful.
Now,
disrespectful.
He proved the doubters wrong, and he's back on top.
0 to 100 real quick.
Exactly. So, why is this win so special for Tiger?
I mean, the post-game, you know, the press conference afterwards, in the interview, he was close to tears. You know, like I said, the back surgeries, he couldn't know if he could walk again, maybe, potentially. So, really, for Tiger, for him, a lot of the times he does that fist bump after wins, right? You know, back in the mid-2000s when he was really dominating. But this time, he kind of raised his hands in the air, almost in disbelief. And just, he's really happy to be back on the road, top of number one.
So, is golf, like the sport of golf, just different with Woods back on top?
Absolutely. I mean, NBC, get this. The ratings boost when Tiger was making his run on Sunday, 206%. I mean, the fact of the matter is, golf really needs Tiger to
Tiger
be great.
Yeah, Tiger sells. Mm-hmm. So do you think this was just a special day for Tiger, or do you think Tiger is back?
I mean, as much as I love to say he's back, I'm not too sure to say that yet. You know, he's 42 years old. You never know, as I alluded to, the back surgeries. But if the Browns can finally snap their winning the losing streak, I think Tiger can come back. Really, anything can happen.
That's such a good point.
Yeah, so Tiger is back. The Browns are winning, you know. It's just a great time to be a sports fan.
It really is.
So after the break, we'll be playing a fun game of Syracuse Headbands. So stick around.
This is the story of a boy who didn't talk for a long time. The boy liked things to always be the same. Any changes would scare and upset him. The unknown was an unfriendly place. The boy was very sensitive to lights and sounds. So he built secret hiding places where they couldn't get in. The boy didn't like looking people in the eye. He wasn't trying to be mean, it just made him feel uncomfortable. Sometimes he would flap his arms again and again.
One day I found out I had something called autism. My family got me help. Slowly, I found my voice and learned all the ways I could live with it better.
Early intervention can make a lifetime of difference. Learn the signs at autismspeaks.org.
When I was in foster care, I never knew when I would have to move. So I always had my suitcase ready to go. Then one day, I was adopted. My new parents opened their hearts and home to me. My parents cook my favorite breakfast for me every morning. My parents take me on trips I never thought I would go on. They gave me a home and an even better reason to use that suitcase. My parents aren't perfect, but they're perfect for me.
So tonight, Sarah and I will be playing a game of Syracuse headbands against Chris and Patrick.
We'll have 30 seconds each to guess as many words as possible on our foreheads. Whichever team guesses the most wins.
So, we'll start. We'll start over here because we're the host.
We are. Okay, I'm so nervous.
Okay.
Wait.
It's upside down.
Yeah, it's upside down. So, okay. Oh my goodness, these are my favorite things. They are chips. They are in like the
Cheetos?
Large. No, they're chips. They're famous at sports
Pita
games in the large place that sporting events happen.
Stadiums.
Uh-huh. Okay. Here, but on Syracuse. In Syracuse. The big sporting event inside.
Football?
No.
A big sporting
event
inside.
What's the stadium called?
Carrier Dome.
Yeah, okay. That, the second part.
Oh, Dome Nachos.
There we go. Okay, got them.
Was that 30 seconds? Do we got a timer out there?
I think we're good.
It looked like 30 seconds.
I think we were good.
I think the shot clock was running out.
That's just, hey, do not even.
All right. It's a bar on campus.
Okay. DJs.
Other one.
Vegas.
Another one.
Harry's.
Yeah.
Oh, come on.
Oh, that was so easy. Are you kidding me?
Right, so
we have like three bars.
You go now. You go now.
It's a game.
We have like three bars.
Don't play the player.
Luck of the draw.
Pizza place on Marshall Street.
Oh, Varsity.
Different one.
Acropolis.
There you go.
Yes.
Easy money.
Alright, I'll be guessing. Now let's, here we go. Alright.
Oh, it's right by Varsity, on right off Marshall Street. You get your morning coffee there.
Oh, Dunkin' Donuts.
Yes. Money.
Oh, this is okay.
Money.
Wow, tight competition.
This is a tight competition. We gotta go, All right. Gotta beat the buzzer.
Try not saying donuts on that one.
Can you turn it? Oh my gosh, he sends us all the emails.
Oh, Pete Salad?
Yes!
that was fast.
The goat.
I get a lot of emails.
The goat himself.
Great restaurant, an Armory Square. It's got great southern style food.
Oh, Dino Barbecue.
Yeah,
let's
go. All right,
go.
Yeah,
We're
really looking.
You ice skate there.
The ice skating rink?
Yeah, what's the name of it?
It starts
with a number after 9.
9, 10?
Yeah, and that's like a part of its name.
10 Ice Field Place?
No.
I don't know.
Next one. It was Tennedy.
Tennedy, ice skating.
Where do you take the bus?
South Campus.
Okay, but different direction.
Centro. North Campus, on campus. No,
a different cardinal direction.
South, Main, West, East, West Campus? BBB?
Yeah, Campus West.
Campus West.
Same thing. It works. I'll take it. Okay.
All right. You know, freshmen go there a lot. Right on Marshall Street. Cookies, ice cream, maybe comedy.
Okay. Quick one.
We're booking.
This is me.
Oh, our mascot.
Oh, Otto the Orange.
Yeah.
That's a layup right there.
All
right.
Well. I mean, I don't know who's keeping score, but I feel like we won.
No.
You guys had a couple passes going at least.
Kennedy.
Yeah.
You did miss Tennedy.
We were pretty fast.
I'm sorry.
All right. You know, we're all a family here at Unpeeled, so
yeah,
we'll say it's a tie.
We'll call it a draw.
Well, that's all the time we have for tonight, Unpeelers.
I'm Sean Onwualu.
And I'm Sarah Rebetje.
Have a great night, Syracuse.